If we are live, hello and welcome. We live, Cam?
We're live, great.
Give me a from the director over there. So hi, everyone, and welcome to Business Reinvented, our live business broadcast that we are doing to help business owners in this time and also moving forward, and something that Cam and I enjoy. So this week, we've got a lot to talk about. We are looking at three lost secrets to reinvent your sales success. So welcome, Cam. How are you?
Yeah, thanks, Steve. Great to be on, folks, and good to be on our weekly live, as Steve said. Usually hang out here on lunchtime, so grab your virtual sandwich and your coffee, sit back and relax for 15 minutes.
Yeah, okay, Cam. Look, can I just ask you, if you're watching this live via Zoom, can you type in the chat there, you know, live? If you're watching it via replay after the fact, please write in, type in replay. And if you're watching on Facebook, give us a comment below to say hi so we know who's here and we can interact. And of course, if you've got any questions, by all means, please ask them. Cam, while that's happening, I just wanted to talk a little bit to start off with about the fickleness of business. And I've just got two examples because, you know, sometimes, you know, we think things are only happening to ourselves, you know, and that can, business, it can be very lonely. And just the two examples I've got, and I won't mention business names, and they have happened, you know, in the last week. I won't mention business names, but one of my clients, they're in the B2B space, and they've just had $1 million month for April.
Wow.
They in sales. They ticked over $1 million yesterday, and there's still 2 days to go in April. So it's, you know, if they make another sale, it's likely to be $1 million-plus month. You know, and when you think about that in the COVID, you know, crisis that we are in, which we're almost coming out of, it seems, but, you know, that's a significant achievement. I'm also aware of a training organization, Cam, that has what I would call a Slack adjuster strategy. And what they do with their 1,500 odd people on their list of prospects, past clients, current clients is whenever they, you know, need some revenue, what they'll do is they'll hire a telemarketer and they will call each of those 1,600 people on their list, set up a meeting, and then from that meeting, they upsell into a course. And the information I saw, I think it was just yesterday or the day before, every time they run this, and they've done this several times over the past couple of years and a couple of times every year, every time they run it, they get about 20 appointments, and of those 20 appointments, they only get two no-shows. So, you know, it's a fairly successful strategy, and one that's, you know, those numbers are fairly typical for, you know, a telemarketer kind of campaign. And so that's worked kind of like clockwork every time they've done it. And they've just run one recently in the last week. And, you know, you're thinking, gee, is it going to work? Well, they got 17 appointments booked. So, you know, only three less than normal, which is fantastic. Yeah. Instead of two no-shows, they had 17 no-shows. Wow, isn't, you know, it's easy to sit there and say in hindsight, well, you know, the world has changed and all that sort of thing, and you should have, you know, you could have known about that, but you don't know what you don't know, and you don't know until you test something. You know, like the first example, they didn't know they were going to have $1 million month in April. You know, at the end of March, the start of April. They still did all the things they normally did. And this particular strategy with the telemarketer was doing all the things they normally did, and it didn't work. It got, you know, they got zero response from it. Well, they got, you know, zero conversions from it is probably a better you know, way of putting it. So today's discussion about three lost sales secret, I think secrets is really important for the current environment, but also to keep in mind that, you know, business can be a fickle and difficult thing. And, you know, as soon as we think we've got it figured out, we get bitten on the bum like that telemarketer campaign that has worked effectively many times before.
Yeah. Especially in, like you said, in COVID-19, things are changing so fast. I mean, let's look at a simple timeline, Steve. 5 weeks ago, we all thought the earth was going to shut down for 6 or 12 months. Like, we had no idea how long we're going to be locked down for. Businesses were closing down. They're still closed down. Some are open, some aren't. So it depends on, you know, what if you're going to do some marketing back then? How does that fit right in the middle? But now the rules have changed again, and they're going to start letting us out. You can go for a drive, or you can do a picnic. Some places can start opening slowly again. So again, the market's changed again. And so it's also an example, Steve, of how flexible you need to be with your marketing and your approach to business.
Yeah, absolutely, Cam. And And I guess that's part of the stuff that we're talking about today is that that flexibility in your sales. So, Cam, why don't we get into the three lost sales or secrets to reinventing your sales success? Why don't we get into them?
Yeah,
so the first secret that I think is really important is to not rush into the sale. You know, I love that saying that people buy in their time, not in our time. You know, as the business owner, well, we want the sale now because we've got revenue targets, we've launched the campaign, we've got all these reasons why they should buy now. But, you know, you flip that around and think back to the last time you went to buy something, you didn't care about the business. Like you had your own agenda, right, as the buyer. You still wanted to shop around, you wanted to weigh things up, to think about it, get permission from your spouse, that sort of thing, not that you or I would do that, but that kind of thing happens out there. So we often, I think, misconstrue when a buyer doesn't go yes straight away. We kind of misconstrue that. So it's a really, it's an important thing about rushing to the sale. What have you got to say about that, Cam?
Yeah, I think it's a really good strategy not to rush into the sale. And, often I teach people and clients that I work with, I teach them how to actually delay the sale intentionally because it actually makes a better customer and a better client. So rushing into the sale, like, creating that urgency to close is different from creating urgency to market, but to create an urgency to try and close fast, sometimes you can damage the relationship right at the end of the finish line. Whereas if you just pull back a little bit and delayed the sale and gave the prospect or the potential customer or client some additional information, some additional resources, some additional collateral, to help educate them, to get them more emotional. So maybe they're already emotional about your product or service, but maybe there's something else that you can give them. If you delayed the sale, it would actually make them more excited or fall more in love with what you're doing.
Yeah, another one of my favorite sayings, this one comes from Brian Kurtz, who cut his teeth in the boardroom, the big mail days back in the 90s. He says that there's always time to sell. There is always time to sell in your relationship. Yeah. And that's why that whole concept of info-first marketing is really important, where, it is okay and you can give away your best stuff and still make the sale. Right.
Yeah. And
in giving
positioning, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah. And in giving away your best stuff, it doesn't mean that you give everything, but there still can be a tease element in there to make them curious to want to take the next step. But, and I guess the other part of that, Cam, is just because something is free doesn't mean, it doesn't have to accomplish something.
That's right.
So you've got to be really thoughtful and careful about what you do in that sales process. And, so someone signs up to your list, the first thing you don't want to do is ask them for money, right? I mean, that's at a very basic level. Send them a blog, send them a nurture sequence, send them some authority pieces.
Build a relationship a little bit more. Yeah. It's like dating, but it's not even like, it's like dating, but I was going to say, it's also like just having a normal friendship. A couple of mates like us hanging out, like we built our relationship over time.
Yeah.
It didn't just happen in the first 5 minutes,
That's right. I was a little bit hard to get, wasn't I, Cam? So
hard to get.
Yeah, that's right.
But it's true in any relationship, isn't it, Steve? Whether it's, a relationship you're chasing someone for dating or love or just a mate's relationship or whether it's a sales relationship, there's things that, you have to do to build that relationship up, to build the trust, to build the connection. And the sale's no different. And you don't want to ruin it right at the finish line by trying to close too hard, too early, too soon.
Yeah, and that can involve things like sending them a copy of your book. It can involve things like sending them a shock and awe, to build that positioning. And that probably that's a nice segue unintentionally into secret number two. And that's, authority is vital. Authority today is so important. You think about all the press conferences we've seen. As soon as the Prime Minister steps up, right, everyone's quiet. Authority is really important. And people go, well, how do I build authority? There are a number of ways, but I think probably the in all of your marketing, you have to show both depth and breadth. And what do I mean by that? Well, so depth is you know, the, I was talking about my client at the start there, you know, they've had $1 million month. So that shows, gee whiz, that shows that, you know, I can do a whole lot of stuff with people, right? There's yeah. depth to that when I mentioned that. And after this call, I'm talking to a prospect in Thailand. I had a meeting with someone in New Zealand yesterday. I've got clients in Perth. So that there's the breadth of, you know, of it there, and that authority thing. And someone might say, well, that's okay for you. You work online, et cetera, but I'm a tradie, you know, how do I do those things? Well, okay. So the number of jobs that you've completed. So how many happy locals are there? You know, you work from Caboolture to Noosa, and you know, that might be your breadth. Well, what about the depth? So what are some complex tasks that you've done? Did you do the plumbing for a unit block? Or
that's right. Yeah. Some sort of unit or some sort of, you know, big thing that people know about in your area.
So in terms of selling, and I guess it's not really, you know, direct selling, but, you know, people always move to people with authority, right? They go to the person at the top of the mountain. So what can you do in your sales process that builds authority for you and for your brand? I think that's really, really important. And, you know, I've got some skin conditions at the moment. You can kind of see there, I've got to go and see a specialist about that, right? The GP doesn't want to know about it because it's kind of complicated, right? So, you know, again, that authority is really important. And of course, I'm going to be paying more at the specialist than I did at the GP. Yeah. And so as much as you can position yourself and your business as that authority within your niche, you know, the safer your business is, and frankly, the easier the sale is as well.
That's right.
You know, it's, I still remember.
I was going to add to that. And the good news is that there's not many of your competitors that are actually good at this. Not many people are good at building authority the right way with their marketing and their sales collateral, are they, Steve?
No, absolutely not. It, you know, it, again, so things like your book, your shock and awe, your whatever content you send out, what are you doing to position you above all others? You know, it's really, really important. I just really quickly can remember too, a story I heard of, this is probably going back 10 years, we're in a seminar room, and the guy got up and he'd had some back surgery, and he was in the doctor's office, and, you know, he's a busy business owner, great guy, really, really good. But he said to the doctor, he said, "Doc, you know, I understand, you know, but I've been waiting here 2 hours, you know, like I run a big business. I'm a busy guy." And the doctor just looked at him and said, "Look, I'm one of 3 people in the world who do this surgery, either sit down or F off." So he said, I sat down and ate my shit sandwich like and waited, you know, and so that's authority, you know, and not that you should be treating your customers that way necessarily, but when you are that authority figure, you know, you can be charging more, and your sale is much easier, and it's a much safer place to be.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And that transitions us into secret number three, and that is to reinvent on a grand scale. So, you know, when you're creating your sales, how could you reinvent what you're already doing and make it something like new and improved? You know, those famous words, there's many companies that make new and improved products, and it's not creating something that's fake or false, but how could you make what you do, your product, your service, whether you're a builder, a tradie, a e-com, you know, you might be in wholesale, whatever it is that you do, how could you make it slightly new, or how could you make it, you know, better in some way, shape or form, or improved? And it doesn't take much to improve a product or service. And it doesn't take much to have something slightly new. It could be a new market that you're going to. It could be a new color. It could be a new model. I mean, think cars. Car companies do this all the time, Steve. They come up with new models of cars. Like, you know, we drive a Jeep. Since we've had our Jeep for 3 years, there's been a couple of new models of Jeeps come out with new features. I mean, it's still the same car. It's still the same SUV. Same shape, still got 4 wheels, a steering wheel, you know, nice seats inside, but they're constantly adding new features to make it a new vehicle. McDonald's also do this really well, Steve. They've always got something new adding on to the menu. Now, they've got their stable products, but it's the new and improved product that gets people to come in and try it. Hungry Jack's do the same thing. Loaded Fries, you know, funky Sunday ice creams, they're new and they're exciting, and they're an improved version of a normal ice cream. you know, an ice cream with things sprinkled on it and some sort of frozen Coke with 52 flavors. That's a new and improved way of serving up ice with water and flavored, you know, flavoring and ice water. So that's a new and improved version. So, you know, when you want to increase the amount of sales that you're making in your business, how could you reinvent that on a grand scale so that you could make that new and improved in your business?
Yeah, I think from a marketing point of view too, Cam, it gives you a story to go to your market and tell, yeah. Right? If you've got something new and improved, or it's new, or there's a new level of something, or there's, you know, there's something different and new, that is a story to tell to the marketplace, yeah. Not just, hey, come and buy my stuff. It's right. There is a reason for people coming and doing that, you know, and that's really important. And the key thing too with newness, it has an effect on the brain. You know, it helps the brain release, or the brain releases dopamine when there's that, yeah, that newness and that stimulation. You know, so from a marketing point of view, that's a really important point. So that can boost sales tremendously as well. So, you know, I think just it's in times like this, it's about ways to creatively and simultaneously respond. And you know, we've talked about three today, the don't rush to the sale. There, yep, is always still time. We've talked about building authority, so making, yep, the sale easier. And we've talked about new and improved. So they're three ways, and we've called them lost secrets because you don't hear people talking about those things an awful lot today, Cam, yeah, you know, and, yeah, and you know, if you came here looking for a magic pill, sorry, we don't do magic pill stuff. But what I would encourage you to do is think of those three principles and how can you apply just one thing from each of those three lost secrets to your business? You know, there, and if you get creative with that, you know, start with the new and improved. To me, that's the easiest way. You know, and work out how you can actually apply that to what you're doing. The authority thing, count up how many clients you've served in the last 5 years. There's a good statement to make. You know, in the last 5 years alone, we've serviced 2,122 clients from Perth to Darwin.
Yeah.
You know, or whatever it is, right? That, yeah, that gives you authority straight away in your niche. You know, and then as part of your marketing, you're not going, you know, hey, it's John here, come and buy my stuff. You're telling your story. Yeah. You know, and it's also, you can tell that authority through your case studies and your testimonials and all those sorts of things as well. So getting that collateral together to tell that story, adding new and improved to it, ways that if you approach it the right way can be really, really useful in boosting sales. So
yeah, great.
I don't know, that's probably about all I've got, Cam. What about you?
Yeah, mate, that's great. That's great. And I guess from here, because we like to keep these short and sharp, Steve. So from here, if folks want to find out more information about us and how they can work with us jointly together, they can go to businessreinvented.com.au. And we're actually running a new and improved program, funny enough.
Which is new. It's improved because we've thought deeply about it, yes. Yeah.
So it's a bit of an intensive, Steve. It's a five-week intensive program that we're running. And what makes this different from anything else that you've ever seen before is that if you have trouble with your marketing, you have trouble with, you know, putting things together, your email marketing, your sales funnels, your ads, whatever it is, we're actually going to lend you our team who are battle-tested, proven. They're the same people that we use very cost-effectively. To use for your marketing as part of that intensive. So what usually happens, Steve, is when people join some sort of program, a coaching program or a marketing program, or work with, you know, some sort of guru, they learn the information or they do the course or the program, but then they've still got to figure it all out by themselves. And even if they figure it out, they still need people to help them do it, or they get stuck on the doing. So what we're doing is we're helping people with the implementation by letting them have access to our team that can get implementation done really, really quickly.
Yeah, absolutely, Cam. And that's one of those shortcuts that everyone loves as well, right?
Yeah.
You know, because even when you hire people, you don't know if they're any good.
Yeah.
And when you find out, it can be too late, right? So, yeah, absolutely. All right, Cam, thanks.
All right, thanks, Steve. Thanks, everyone. We'll see you soon.
Thanks. Bye for now.